Greiner Talks, about sustainability and transformation. A Greiner podcast episode.
How can we become sustainable as a company, and how can we become sustainable as society? That's what we are discussing here. Today, we're focusing on green energy and football. My guest is a true change maker. He is the founder of Ecotricity, a UK-based provider of green energy. He's also the owner and chairman of Forest Green Rovers, also known as the world's greenest football club. And he's one of the executive producers of the Netflix documentary Seaspiracy. Hello, and thanks for joining, Dale Vince.
Hello, and pleasure to be with you. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for taking your time. And Dale, before jumping into the conversation, I'd like to know from you, what came first? Was it your passion for football or the passion for sustainability?
Sustainability by about 25 years. No, 20 years, I don't know.
What sparked that passion, that motivation?
I was concerned about sustainability since I was a kid. And I remember my first kind of concern was about all of the cars on the road and how much fuel they carried, where it came from and when it was going to run out, because nobody talks about that. I was about 10 or 11. And that seemed wrong to me because I knew stuff ran out from the things I made as a kid that I powered with batteries and things like that. So that bothered me since I was a kid. Then as an adult, I went on the road, lived off grid for about 10 years, looking for a low impact way to live, and then dropped back in to do green energy in the early 90s.
So you're already mentioning it. You started your business in the early 90s. I think it was mid-90s when you started with a single windmill to produce green energy. Quite a lot has happened since then. Can you share something more? And can you tell us what is Ecotricity all about?
Yeah, so I began in the early 90s, like 91. I was living on a hill in my trailer at the end of a 10-year decade of living on the road. I had a windmill on my roof powering my life. And I had an epiphany. I saw the first wind farm built in Britain, went and chatted to the farmer, and I thought, I could spend another 10 years living like this myself, low impact-wise, or I could drop back in and try and build a big windmill to make a bigger change. And I was aware of the climate crisis, and I was aware that energy in Britain was the biggest single source of carbon emissions. And so it made sense to me to tackle that first. So in 1991, I dropped in, set about trying to build a big windmill. It took until 1996 to build it. And the same year, I began Ecotricity, the world's first green energy company. Until then, nobody made green energy available to end users. And that's how it all kicked off. In the early 2000s, having made a lot of progress in green energy and the biggest single source of carbon emissions, we went looking for the second and the third and found it was transport and food, respectively. And excitingly, that energy, transport, and food is 80% of everybody's personal carbon footprint. And so we began to explore and build businesses in transport and food, as well as energy. And that led to the formation of the group we are now, the Green Britain Group.
And can you give us an idea, what's the size of that group? What's your impact? How much energy are you producing?
Yeah, so as Ecotricity, we built about 100 megawatts of wind and solar projects. We built Britain's first megawatt-scale wind and megawatt-scale solar project. We introduced green gas to Britain in 2010, and we're about to build our first green gas mill fed entirely from grass. And we run a smart grid function. We're about to build battery storage as well. In transport, we built the Nemesis, Britain's first electric car. We started that project in 2008. Having that on the road in 2010 led us to build the electric highway. I think it was the world's first national network for charging points for electric cars. And in the same year, 2010, we bumped into Forest Green, which was a rescue mission. And we put all of our thinking and work on energy, transport, and food into that football club. And out of that football club, we started a food venture called Devil's Kitchen. And we make plant-based school dinners for 3,000 primary schools in Britain now.
Wow, that's quite a lot of different projects. And just to give me an idea, to give our listeners an idea, what's 100 megawatt? What is that compared to like a city or a country? Can you give us an idea?
I think it's about 100,000 homes. It's enough energy for about 100,000 homes, which is a quarter of a million people or something like that in our country. So we're a company of 800 people. And we turn over this year £280 million. So that's how big we've become.
And that's quite a progress from a single windmill to where you are today. And I think it's very, very much needed, that kind of impact, because just recently the IPCC released its latest report on the state of climate change. And it shows in a pretty bold way that we are facing an emergency, a climate emergency. And it also tells us if we continue the way we do business today, we are actually heading straight for disaster. So we are not doing enough and we are too slow. And I'm talking here about politicians, I'm talking about companies, but I'm also talking about consumers. So my question to you is, if we are realistic, do you think that we have any chance at all to limit global warming to below 1.5 degrees?
I'm going to say yes and no. So on the yes side of that answer, we have the technology that we need. We need to replace fossil fuels with renewable energy. The wind and sun are mature forms of renewable energy, mass-produced, reliable, cost-effective, and obviously clean. In transport, we need to electrify everything. The electric car revolution is well underway. Buses are on the roads. Lorries are coming out of R&D. And planes will be in the skies in 10 years' time. So it's absolutely possible to replace fossil fuels in transport. Food, we have to just simply stop eating animals. It's really that easy. So in energy, transport and food, we've got everything we need. It's also more cost effective to do it than to not do it. It's also better for our health. And people want it increasingly. So we have all of the ingredients. Businesses are adopting these new products very quickly because they feel the pull from consumers. I hate the word, but it kind of serves a purpose. On the no side of that answer, I would say what we're missing is a government anywhere in the world, really, that gets it enough. Maybe Joe Biden might be the exception. It remains to be seen. But we don't have politicians, definitely in our country here in Britain, that get it and are doing anywhere near enough about it. So on the yes side, we've got everything we need. On the no side, except politicians.
So you're already mentioning it. We have all the ingredients. We know what to do. Scientists tell us what to do. We have the solutions at hand, but it's still not happening. How can we wake up politicians? What can we do? What can we contribute as a company?
We have to make our voices heard. Politicians tend to follow what they think people want in the same way that businesses do. They react to what they think people will buy. Politicians are just the same. And right now, our economy, economies of all the whole world really, are skewed to the old way of doing things. We support fossil fuels and pollution and factory farming. And we put more money into those than we put into renewable energy. So what we need governments to do is to change the economic background so that we reduce support for fossil fuels. Over 5 years, we could reduce it from 12 billion today in Britain to nothing, and we could spend that money instead on renewable energy. So the net cost is nothing. We just switch support from old to new. Same with factory farming. It's very easy. We just somehow we've got to persuade politicians that it's the most important thing that they could do, and that they need to kind of bite this bullet, you know, it's not unpopular, but even if it is, it's worth doing, and they should not think about their own career. They should think about life on this planet and make this change, see what happens.
Speaking of economy and industry, now we are an international producer of foam and plastics, more than 12,000 people in more than 30 countries around the world. Our goal is to be a climate neutral company by 2030. Now, one of the most important measures in this way is, you have already mentioned it, is switching to renewable energy. In Austria, all our facilities are already powered by renewable electricity since 2019, actually. But worldwide, we are standing at 26%. So there's still quite a lot to do to reach our targets. Do you have any advice for us? Like, how can we accelerate that transformation?
Yeah, I think I'd just say try harder. You know, I don't know what your facilities look like. I imagine you've got big rooftops. You could deploy solar energy there yourselves, for example. And if you've already done that, or if those rooftops aren't big enough and you need to go further, then build something nearby. Wherever you are in the world, build something, a windmill, a solar project, and take care of your own electricity needs that way. It's an essential first step.
That's what we are looking into, because there's the solution to buy certificates and you could be basically climate neutral by tomorrow, but that's not what we want to do. We want to focus on more long-term solutions and on infrastructure, or something called PPAs, for example, power purchasing agreements.
Yeah, I'm familiar with that. And I commend you for wanting to do it the right way. Just buying certificates from something that's already been built is an illusion. We established Britain's first commercial PPA in the year 2000. For Sainsbury's. We built a windmill at a factory site for Sainsbury's. Then we did it for Ford and Michelin and all kinds of other people. We call it merchant wind power. Basically, you drop a big renewable energy project on the customer side of the grid connection. So it's off the grid. You don't pay to use the grid at all. And you put the energy exactly where it's used, which is the most economic way to do it.
And breaking it down to the view of consumers, to the view of our listeners, how can each one of us contribute to reduce CO2 emissions? Like, is switching to renewable energy the smartest thing you can do?
Yeah, I think it's definitely one thing. And you have to apply a little bit of caution in the same way that you've described your own position as a company. You can buy certificates and be carbon neutral tomorrow. People can buy green electricity and look like they've taken care of the issue tomorrow. But if you buy it from a company that only buys certificates and doesn't build anything new, then it's not really taken care of at all. So I would say choose wisely when you choose an energy company. But more generally, what I think is the beauty of the discovery we made in the early 2000s is that with energy, transport and food being 80% of everybody's personal carbon footprint, it means the power is in our hands, because it's about how we power our homes with green energy, how we travel and what we eat. And we make spending decisions every day, lots of them. And if we start to change those and point them in a different direction, we can change the way the world goes around. Power is in our hands to do that. So that sends signals to businesses to produce more of those vegan options or electric cars or whatever it is. And those businesses in turn send signals to government to say, hey, we need some support here to change the way the economy works so that we can make these things happen faster and better.
And sending signals, I guess that's also what your work at the Forest Green Rovers is about to a certain extent. So kind of changing topics, we have touched upon it in the beginning. You are the chairman, you are the co-founder of this football club called the Forest Green Rovers. And the FIFA called it the world's greenest football club. Now, you're based in a small town in South England and you're playing in the third division of the English Football League. I'd like to know from you, what makes the Rovers the world's greenest football club?
Yeah, I think it's everything that we've done. We took our blueprint of energy, transport and food and we applied it to football. There's stuff around the edges as well. It's not everything. We have an organic football pitch. We capture the water from underneath the pitch and we use it again, which is a really big climate change issue in water. We've created wildlife borders. We've done... We've taken out single-use plastic. We've got zero to landfill, as well as the usual stuff of being powered by green energy, having electric cars and vans and charging points, and an entirely plant-based menu for staff, fans, and players. So it's everything, really. Oh, and we went carbon neutral about 4 years ago with the UN, a program they call Climate Neutral Now. And it's a three-step program to measure your carbon footprint, to reduce it year on year, and to offset the part that you can't get rid of in any given year. And we've done the measuring and reducing for many years, so we knew our footprint was 200 tons. And so we offset that with the UN. We were the first sports club in the world to achieve carbon neutrality that way. I think that was part of it, because both the UN and FIFA say that we're the greenest football club in the world, which is no small accolade, and we are a small football club.
Congratulations on that. And Dale, in 2019, you have also been awarded as climate ambassador for the UN initiative Sports for Climate Action. Do you believe that sports can help to raise awareness for that kind of transformation that we need as a society?
Absolutely. And, you know, Forest Green Rovers began for us as a rescue mission, an old football club in our backyard that was in trouble. And we didn't think it beyond that. We just jumped in to help out. And then we realized we had to change everything. And then we realized we had an opportunity to talk to a new audience of people about something they didn't hear very much about: football fans and the environment. And we've created this green football club, this improbable combination of football and the environment. And it's carried our message around the world. In the last 12 months, we've had 5 billion impressions in all forms of media, you know, radio, TV, online, that kind of stuff. And we hooked up with the UN in 2018, 2019, because they had the same idea that we could reach sports fans and get them to become fans of the environment. And there are billions of them in the world. And so we're founding members of the Sport for Climate Action Program. And that's its central premise: get the world of sports involved in the fight against the climate crisis and get sports fans, you know, pulling their weight from the grassroots, really. And Our own experience with Forest Green has been entirely that this audience of people are open to the idea. They just need to be presented with the problems and the answers, to be given ideas about what they can do at home, and they embrace it. You know, our fans are driving electric cars. They've gone veggie and vegan in their own lives, not just at a football game. They've got solar panels, all that kind of stuff. You know, our fans have become fans of the environment. It's worked incredibly well.
And speaking of that improbable combination of football and the environment, that kind of reminds me of this combination of plastics and the environment, or plastics and sustainability. I'm wondering, could you share any learnings with us that could be beneficial for an international company like Greiner? I mean, the size is very different from this football club to our company, but maybe there's some learning, something that you can share out of your experience.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, over the last 10 years that we've been doing this, I've had a lot of conversations with a lot of different sports clubs, and they all have the same kind of issue, which is the feeling, the perception that their fans will not take kindly to change, particularly a change of diet through a change of menu. And our experience is actually that there's less to fear there than anybody thinks. We dived in with both feet because that's the way we are. We were never not going to make this change. But what we did was we took the time to explain to our fans why we did everything that we did. And we showed them gently, subtly, if you like, that this was something they could also do at home. What we didn't do was preach to anybody or tell them what they must do. For example, with food, we said, look, come and try our food. But if you don't like it, bring your own. It's not a problem. We're simply setting the menu according to our values. And then let people get on with it. And so people come to a football club and they see a range of things that we're doing. So we show by doing, and we encourage them to think about that themselves. They go and it does sink in and people start to change how they live.
Dale, it seems like you're quite a busy person and we need to change a lot of things. So you're also involved in many different projects besides football and green energy. Another one is this documentary that I mentioned in the beginning. It's called Seaspiracy, and it causes quite a lot of discussions. So very briefly, for our listeners who haven't heard of it yet, can you just tell us a few words about it?
Yeah, it's a film from the people that made Cowspiracy, which really lifted the lid on factory farming for cows in the main, but it applies to all forms of animal factory farming. And they came to me a few years ago, said they wanted to make a similar film about what's happening in the oceans. Industrial fishing is really incredibly damaging for the environment. And so we chucked a bit of money in to help make the film happen. And, you know, it's a shocking, eye-opening film. I've heard from so many people that have said they will no longer eat fish now that they've seen that film. It's very interesting. So it's done its job, I would say.
I'd love to ask more questions about that movie because I've just recently seen it myself. But unfortunately, we're slowly coming to an end of this episode today. But before I let you go, Dale, I'd like to invite you to do a short word wrap with me, if that's fine for you. So I would give you one word and you could reply with whatever comes to your mind.
that could be interesting.
Let's give it a try. So the first one is Bristol City FC.
Our friends. But we did beat them in the cup recently.
Cheltenham FC.
Our friends as well. Neighbours, and there's slightly more competition between us. This is more than one word, but I hope that's okay.
Less controversial. Travelling.
Oh, yeah, I like it. You know, I'm a fan of travelling, but I mean, oddly enough, the last 10 years, I haven't really travelled anywhere. I'm a traveller that doesn't like to go anywhere, but I might get back to it.
Your rooftop.
Solar panels, ideally, but not in the house I live in. It's one of those listed buildings which you can't do anything with.
Electric cars.
Fantastic. Bikes are better.
Fish and chips.
Yeah. Actually, it can be done without the fish.
I'll give that a try. Renewable energy.
It's the future.
And last but not least, your message to the world.
We know what we need to do. And we have everything that we need to do it. We just need to get on with it.
Thank you so much for taking your time and for that optimistic ending, Dale.
Yeah, no problems. Pleasure. Thank you.
And also make sure to check out Dale's own podcast called Zero Carbonista. Have a look at the website of Ecotricity. And don't forget to subscribe to our podcast on Spotify, Apple Music, or wherever. Stay healthy and have a great day.
Greiner Talks, a Greiner podcast. Subscribe now.